with those verses, we close the book, go home, huh? Powerful. You know, when Peter was walking on his own, he said, "Oh Lord, all these go their way. I won't make you. I would never forsake you." He was walking in his own strength. He was walking by the arm of flesh. He meant everything he said. He really did believe it. He would have died with the Lord if the Lord was willing to fight. The Lord wasn't fighting. You know, I mean, he took that sword in the garden and he swatted at that man and took his ear off. He showed he wasn't a warrior, he was a fisherman. If he was a warrior, he would have took his head off. But I think when Jesus reached down and picked up that ear and fixed it, made it whole, Peter didn't know what to do. Peter was totally lost because everything he thought up to that moment just changed. Jesus wasn't going to fight. He was going to the cross. Peter didn't know how to handle it. He ran away. But it was a little girl that God used to straighten him out. He really had to take a look at himself. When that little girl called him a Galilean, "You're one of them." "No, I'm not." Be under our own strength. That's who we are. That's who we are. Just like Peter, unconverted. Under our own strength. But thank God, Peter did become converted.
Yeah.
And he wrote those precious words. How precious is that? "According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertaining unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us unto glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust." What is it that you're after today, brothers and sisters? What is it that you really, really want in your heart of hearts? Because if there's nothing else I've learned in this life, I've learned that we find what we're looking for.
Amen.
What are you looking for? You know, it's amazing because things can fly by us every day and we never pay any attention to them because we never were looking for them. You know, I use an illustration of a... Say I went to my sister's party, and this guy shows up that's a friend of my sister's that I never knew. But he drives up in this big fancy Maserati, and he takes me for a ride in that car. And I'm like, wow, this is an awesome car. I mean, I've never seen one of these things. You know, this is totally awesome. I get home, I go back to work Monday morning. I park in the same spot I've been parking it for 25 years. And the guy that parks right next to me drives a Maserati, different color. Never saw it. Never paid any attention to it. Because I wasn't looking for it. Brothers and sisters, I hope you're looking for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because if you're living in this world and you're not as one-sighted and looking for him like you want nothing else more than you want that life, then you will miss him. It's just that simple. I entitled this little talk because, you know, we have communion today, and, you know, you got to be quick because there's a lot that needs to be done. And I just want to put in your mind that we take up an offering at the end of communion service, and it's for the needy in our group that need help. And that will be in the back there. So just maybe you could think about what you might put in that plate when we're done with today. I named this little talk, "What Table Do You Eat At?" What table do you eat at? And if I had a subtitle for this little talk, it may be, "We Are What We Eat." Aren't we? We are what we eat. And who are we eating with? What table do we get served at? Because you can't sit at the Lord's table and sit at the devil's table. There is no middle ground, brothers and sisters. Though the devil would like us to believe that there is no middle ground. Let's turn our Bibles to 1 John. You're almost there. 1 John 2 and 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doth the will of God abideth forever.
Amen.
Amen. So how do we avoid the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life? How do we do that?
Be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves.
Amen. Being filled with the Spirit. How do we become filled with the Spirit?
Ask for it.
We ask for the Spirit.
Believe you've received it.
Believe you've received it. Amen.
Live like you've received it.
Ah. There's an important aspect. You know, it's one thing to say we believe, and it's another thing to really believe. I like the word believe, because that's doing what you believe. My vernacular, I don't know, that's not really a word, but I like that word. Believe. So when I see the word believe, that's what I see. Believe. Because it's so easy to say it. It's so easy to pretend. It's so easy to be a phony and a sham. But who are you really? Who do you really hang out with? Who do you really spend time with? What table are you really eating? Let's turn our Bibles to John. John 16 and 33. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. How many of you fight with tribulation? How many of you have hard times? You know, doesn't the Bible tell us to rejoice in all things? You know, I know that God knows how to handle setbacks, because I've been handed a setback. And this thing really threw me for a loop. I guarantee you, because when I broke my arm that day and the bone was sticking out, almost made two men pass out because they couldn't handle it, I had to have a couple women help me. I'd tell you something, huh? Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Anyways. Probably good to have women in the military.
Amen.
You know? Unbelievable. So, when that all happened, I called my wife and said, you know, I think I broke my arm. You know, I'd take a little ride to the hospital. I'm not going to be home tonight. But I really honestly believe that a couple weeks I was going to hit the ground running. You know, I never had surgery before and all that. I tell you what, this is quite a wake-up call for me. Everything in my life has come so easy to me. This has been the hardest darn thing I've ever done in my life. This thing just has really rocked me. I can't believe how difficult it's been to get my hand moving again. The pain is pain. It's not a big deal. But just the fact that my body doesn't obey me, you know? It's pretty... I had to have Marty come over and move this. I don't have enough strength to do. It's unbelievable. And God has really used this time to shake me up, to really get my attention. Because I realized, looking backward, that it was pride that put me on the ground like that. Me and my own stupid attitude. So I was going to save a few minutes of time. It's cost me, since November 6th? Yeah. And I'm up at 2:30 every morning. I'm ready to go trucking. I got nowhere to go. 30 years of living out of a bag, and I walked the house at 2:30 in the morning, talking to the Lord. Or I should be in my truck going down the road. But it ain't what it is. Everything I own is standard. My pickup is standard. My big truck, 18 gears, can't shift that. My motorcycle, I can't drive. I have to borrow my dad's pickup that's automatic. I don't even want to drive his pickup. But that's what I got to drive. It's amazing. You know, I see myself a lot like Peter. I am a lot like Peter. And God just has a way of getting a hold of guys like me. He used a little girl to get a hold of Peter. He uses a little girl to get my attention too. He does. It's really amazing. But you know, we have to rejoice in all things, don't we? Because it's almost, I see this thing as destiny. Really. This had to happen. I can't explain it, but it had to happen. This is God's way of training me. And I don't like it one bit. But he's showing me in the storm that I'm not the man. He's the man.
Amen.
And I will follow. And I'm thankful if he has to break another bone, that I would go into heaven broken and not able to move my limbs the way that I would like them to move, rather than to miss heaven. I'm thankful for the way God has led in my life and the different things that he's done. Because looking back, well, I tell you what, when you really stop and take time to look back, you can really check out all the spots where God was really working. You know? When you think he's not there is the time that he's most close. He really is. And he loves us so much. I'm so thankful that God was so willing to send his son to die for our sins. Turn your Bibles to Colossians. Chapter 2. You get there, just say amen.
Amen.
Chapter 2 and verse 8. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Boy, there's so much there. I could spend the next hour just going over that. But we don't have time for all this. I want to get, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In whom?
Christ.
In Jesus. Boy, I tell you, is that a powerful verse right there? In him, in Jesus, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also ye are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Amen.
Do you really believe that? Because
Amen.
If you really believe that, you should be shaken up. You should be on fire to think that God has moved heaven and earth to take your sin upon himself. Listen, brothers and sisters, your sins, Jesus purchased at the cross. You do not own them. They are his. They belong to him. So why would you continue to hang on to something that's not yours? That's stealing. That's stealing. Let's believe God and give him what's his. And that's our sins. And follow him. Follow him all the way home. It's amazing to me. You know, it talks about in Job. I'll close this thing. There's no way I'm going to get anywhere into this. I got up at 1 o'clock this morning because whenever I got to get up here, I just want to spend a little extra time with the Lord. You know? And I got so much here, there's no way we're going to get to it all. But when these kings came before the Lord in Job 1 to present themselves before God. They were all the commanders of the different worlds, correct? And Satan came, right? And what did Satan say? Jesus says, God says to him, where do you come from? He says, well, I come from the earth, going to and fro in the earth. What does that mean? It means he was the king of the earth. He has dominion of the earth. Adam gave him that dominion, correct? Do you realize that Jesus, the second Adam, God Almighty, took that dominion back from Satan? And he is not just God of all creation, which he is in every aspect. Everything bows the knee to him. But he, Jesus, took on flesh. He exalted us to a position that you can't even wrap your mind around. Do you stop and think for a moment that there is a man that sits on the throne of Almighty God because Jesus condescended to put on this flesh? What more could Jesus do? What more could he give than he's given? His very life he gave. Not for a moment, but forever. Forever in eternity. He is ours and we are his.
Amen.
That is so, so powerful. So, so powerful. Psalm 48 says, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Thy law is within my heart. This is what we want, brothers and sisters. This is where we want to be with Jesus. Allowing him to take from us what belongs to him so that he can give to us what belongs to him. He wants to do this. And if we will relive it, he will do it. Listen, it's sad to me that the world has to get so dark, so, so dark to wake the church up. Do you realize that the times we're living in is ripening the earth? Ripening what? God's people and the devil's people. It's all coming to a very close head, brothers and sisters. Time is short. You know, I want to give you one thing and we're going to close with that because we're just like kind of out of time here. Revelation 12:12, and this is where I'll close. Revelation 12:12. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath. What if I stop there? You don't want me to stop there, do you?
Oh,
let's read the rest of that. Because he knoweth that he hath but what? Learn something from the devil today, brothers and sisters. Time is short. This thing's wrapping up. It's just about over. The only safe place is on the ark. It's only on the ark. Now we're going to separate for the ordinance of humility. The men will go in the back and the women will go to what door?
Blue door.
The blue door. Where the water is, the blue door.